relates to the same uncertainty between, I think, listening. There's an uncertainty, a vagueness between subject and object. Learn to listen, and there's not, yeah, there's an unconscious culture of learning to listen, of course, and all the sounds and the language and so on, but there's a lot to learn. And that makes also the difference of different ears of people. I mean, some people are learn more or different things of listening. And I think that also relates to the kind of difficult position that music is in our culture.
The objectification has caused, you know, I think, music to paint itself into a corner.
Yeah.
And now it doesn't know where to go.
So music is scary for many people. And attractive, but
some music is scary. Sorry, I just wanted to know what you said. I didn't get the first word.
Yeah, music. Oh, music in general. I mean, some music is more scary. I mean, new music that people don't know is very scary for normal people because they don't know and they really get this.
Well, it depends on the context. You know, Joel Ryan said to me, and that was, you know, why didn't I think of that before? He said a lot of the music that people find really scary when they have to listen to it is completely accepted as film.
Yeah, but then it's
there's contextualized.
With visual elements and so on. So that's
and it still does its work emotionally. And it just
but also the non-verbal development.
Yeah,
the music is so non-verbal, and it seems that the visual is verbal.
Both language and visual things are very much related to objectifying things that you see independently of yourself.
But it's about relating, of course, the ways you relate to listening and to that you are not conscious that you are related to in some way to listening. Moreover, the visual has more power. It's more powerful.
Yeah, maybe we can make that a topic. I'll write that down so we can make sure we
address it.
Keep focused. I'm Sharon Stewart, and I'm a pianist, and that was my training. And then I went to The Hague, and I got a master's in music pedagogy, and then I started looking into feminism, synchronization technology, this research. And came across Pauline Oliveros, and for me, it's the meditational aspects of listening that I find fascinating. Also, just the fact that when listening, doing listening meditation, that I feel happier afterwards and more connected. So it has this psychological kind of impact. And also, what power when people enter a listening state that is impossible to. Everyone's listening differently, but it's kind of a tangible kind of result that you get. When people are listening to each other,
is peering now more or less?
Well, I tried that for a week, a kind of thing. Can I listen while I move? So while I'm biking, can I bicycle and listen in the same openness? And it was informative. Yeah.
But you could say that since the 19th century, serious listening is not considered a kind of listening in which you do other things or try to move along with either the sounds you're hearing or whatever. No, serious listening means.
I'm not serious in the sense of.
Well, there's serious earnest or. No, I mean. But serious in the sense of compelled, really listening, whatever that might mean. Really listening means, okay, you're not allowed to do anything else but to sit still and
you concentrate on what
you're doing. Yeah, exactly.
And you calm, in a way, you calm the body, you still the body. And I still, I mean, it is problematic to be active in the body and still. Yeah, find the same level of intensity of listening as you can get when you're still, while you're moving. But
I think there's a huge difference between biking or doing something with movement and listening to music that's unrelated, or between listening and dancing or moving with the music.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because the last thing is a way of listening with the body, I think.
Yeah.
And that's a whole different way of understanding. And even if you sit still, I sometimes kind of imagine movements with the music, and that helps me with listening. It makes the music more vibrant.
Yeah, or having a conversation while there's music playing.
But that's
something. No, for me, that's very important for our listening. Years ago, I wanted to buy new speakers. And you go to these stores, and you know, you can listen to the speakers. And I would always bring a friend, and I would always start talking with them. Because that's how I normally listen to music. 9 out of 10 times, that's how I listen to music. It's only rarely that I sit down like this, chair in exactly the right position, and concentrate on the music. But I really enjoy good music that's playing while I'm having a good conversation with a friend. And the context is completely different.
Yeah.
And the guys in the store were so you should listen to the speakers. I am listening to the speakers in a very unconscious way.
Yeah.
I would buy magazines and start reading these magazines while we were, and they were completely baffled by the fact that I would sort of manipulate the whole idea of the context of, you know, about listening. But it is a completely different experience.
So would you then say this, well, perhaps 19th century conception of concentrated listening might already be outdated for
I think there's another dimension to this, is that religion comes into it, or at least the soul, at the very least, in the sense of, because you're talking about creating a space for listening, and I mean, there's a whole concept of inner voice.
Better when you are focused and in one point. I don't think always, I think you can train yourself to listen to all those layers, but to let it in you, into you, it's nice to stand and or to be blindfolded or whatever, and to have space and sources, or sources in space.
That's it.
The resistance, the ones you gave me,
Well, one voltage and second voltage. But when you do math, you know, those are easy.
In the music, in one form or another, let's try and go 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 3, 1, 3, 9, 3, 3, 1. So much concentration, lovely. Cool. Let's do a full three. So this will be a full three. It would be 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1. And then just for reference, let's try and do a five. So let's do a three with 2, 1. So we're going to do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 2, 3, 4, 5. 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Great. Nobody's dropping. We need to.
Whoa.
as a speaker. And if you can, think of relaxing these two things at 1, 2, 4, 1. And in the other hand, if you're brave, 1, 2, 1, 1. Nice. Nobody's dropping. 1, 2, 3. And then let's make it a 5. And if you're brave, do both sides. Don't try both sides. And don't worry, you will drop on this. You know what? You're all very good at this. The 1,000 euro challenge. Well, no, I don't have a challenge. The big challenge. No, I don't have. Not my last bit. The big challenge. So you threw under the leg, and you caught under the leg. Throw under the leg. It might be worth just doing it without, so pull her. Boom. Here we go. Throw, he taps, hopefully. Throw, he taps. Throw,
he taps. How many euros? More than 1,000 euros. Probably need to move the car. Thank you.
I'm Rem Clark.
You have talented.
I mean, Basil.
Okay. I deleted them, so yeah, there are very few of them. Anyway, but I needed to be empty anyway, so the camera.
Okay, but I can grab them from you tonight.
I don't have them, but it's
he has it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Changes the game.
Yeah.
And then these, yeah, these Slippers, yeah.
Where did you go?
There's the brew.
Mag
ik jouw soldeerbaat dan nog even?
Ja hoor.
Wat is de bedoeling daarvan?
Ja, dat zijn onze in- en uitgebreide.
So we're going to try it out now. And it might be this one. But I think.